Hello, teachers, and welcome to episode 3 of the 1918 Spanish Flu. We're glad you're back here with us. I'm here with Kenneth C. Davis, the author of More Deadly Than War, The Hidden History of the Spanish Flu and the First World War. And I'm Jessica Ellison. I'm a teacher educator at the Minnesota Historical Society. And today on episode 3, we're going to talk about obey the laws and wear the gauze. And so we'll come back to these primary sources, but first we're going to check in with Kenneth and ask a couple of questions. So Kenneth, hello, how are you?
Hi, Jessica. It's great to be with you again. And before we do that, I'm reminded all of a sudden it popped into my head. There was a song that children used to jump rope to and it went like this. I had a little bird, its name was Enza. I opened up the window and in flew Enza. It was a song that children sang in 1918 as they jumped rope or just playing. It actually, you know, was a part of the culture at the time. And we forget about that. You know, when we talk about how the government responded or what the official response was, how the medical world responded, but people responded in their own ways, and children actually made a game out of this. It's quite extraordinary.
It makes me wonder if there's any coronavirus poems or anything going around. I'm sure we will hear about those at some point. Well, let's talk today about the response. And two cities at different parts of the country had very different responses. So Philadelphia and St. Louis are widely described as being cities that had different responses. So can you talk a little bit about what was done in each city?
Absolutely. It's a really important story to the kind of themes we've been talking about here. First of all, the connection to the war and the flu, then also the official response. As the flu came back in September, as we discussed this in a previous episode, it was really starting in army bases, but then moving into the civilian population. First in Boston in September of 1918, sailors from Boston then went to Philadelphia, and Philadelphia naval bases and military bases started to see a high incidence of, again, this very deadly influenza outbreak. Now, Philadelphia, in the midst of this nearby outbreak in its military camps, is getting ready to have a big parade. The parade was for something called the Liberty Loan Drive. Liberty loans were war bonds. And this was also part of the propaganda effort of the period. The government was paying for the war through the sale of bonds. And they were really made this a tremendous marketing campaign across the nation. Men would come into theaters, schools, churches, YMCA gatherings, and give a spiel that lasted 4 minutes. They were called 4-Minute Men. And they really forced people to buy these war bonds. It was an act of patriotism, an act of loyalty. And if you didn't do it, you would really be held up as a disloyal person. So there was a tremendous amount of social stigma attached to not doing your part, as they said. Now, part of this was also having big spectacles, parades, patriotic parades, proud parades to show off everyone's fighting spirit. And in Philadelphia, they were planning a parade for September 28th, 1918. And the health commissioner in Philadelphia was told not to allow this parade to go on because the flu was around. It was too dangerous to have a large crowd. He refused. He thought it was more important, and his political superiors told him it was more important to go on with the parade and the war bond effort than to worry about the flu. It was just the flu, as they said. Well, 200,000 people crowd into Philadelphia's main street. Bands are marching by, Boy Scouts, women's auxiliaries, soldiers, sailors, airplanes are flying overhead, and remember, the airplane is brand new. No one had ever seen a warplane before. And they were flying overhead above the parade. So it was an extraordinary moment. Now, 2 days later, after that parade, every hospital bed in Philadelphia's 30 hospitals was filled with flu sufferers. There was such a wave of pandemic hitting Philadelphia that something like 12 to 15,000 people died in a few weeks. It's an extraordinary number. Clearly, the men in charge had ignored sound science. That's one of the lessons. So Philadelphia then tried to shut down its schools, its churches, its theaters, its public places, bars and restaurants, just as we're seeing in the United States today in many locations. It was too little, too late, and Philadelphia was one of the worst hit cities in America. St. Louis, which is a little further west, of course, we can get the maps out and talk some geography, could see this progression from Boston to Philadelphia, and they decided they were going to do something about it first. So they went into lockdown mode before the flu really got to be too bad. They knew there were cases on a nearby army base, again, the connection to the military. They canceled their parade, they closed the bars, they closed the restaurants, the theaters, they even closed the churches and the schools eventually. And St. Louis's chart of the flu, if you look at one of those flatten the curve type charts, was much, much lower than Philadelphia's. So two different cities with very different reactions, and one worked much better than the other, with tragic results in the case of Philadelphia.
And again, we see so many parallels to how different cities are handling this, you know, and we know that states and localities have a lot of control over what they do in their own places. And I think we're seeing that here as different states take different measures to try to fight this coronavirus pandemic as well. So this was a really great lesson in how two cities handled the Spanish flu. So at the time in 1918, then masks were widely used. Were they effective? What else was done that was effective?
Well, I started out, we were talking about a nursery rhyme or jump rope rhyme that kids used, but there was also a widely spoken rhyme that went, that said, obey the laws and wear the gauze. Now, gauze meant the gauze mask, because that's what they were making masks of in that time. And the gauze mask became by far the most familiar iconic symbol of the Spanish flu epidemic. And on the cover of More Deadly Than War, you can see two young boys. These were newsboys. I think this was in Florida, who had their gauze masks on. Many cities required them. You couldn't get on the streetcar, for instance, in many cities unless you were wearing the gauze mask. Did they do any good? Well, unfortunately, for the most part, not. One, the gauze mask that they used at the time was much thinner in a way, because it has, gauze allows things in. They didn't understand what a virus was, and we haven't really talked about this part of this. We didn't understand a virus in 1918. No one had ever seen one. Bacteria had been seen under regular microscopes, but a virus, which is so much smaller than bacteria, wouldn't be seen for another 20 years until the advent of the electron microscope. So no one really knew what they were fighting against. So the gauze mask, which was basically layers of gauze wrapped around your face, were ineffective because they allowed too much a virus to get through. Viruses are so small. People also didn't understand that just because you had a mask on doesn't mean you should touch your face, which is much more dangerous than actually breathing something. Many people get sick because they have virus on their hands and then introduce it into their nose, mouth, or even eyes. So the flu mask, as it was called at that time, even though it was widely used, really didn't help much. The other thing is that people reused the same mask time and time again without cleaning it properly, and very often the mask itself would become infected, and then you were just introducing an infected mask onto your face. So gauze masks and the flu masks, even though very widespread, really did not help. Not much of anything helped in the case of the Spanish flu. As I said, they didn't understand what a virus was. There were no vaccines at the time for a flu virus. They wouldn't come along until the 1940s. Again, we had to understand what a virus was. There was very little medicine at that time. We today have viral drugs, retroviral drugs. We have fever controllers. At that time, basically all doctors had was aspirin. And here's another point about propaganda and fear. Aspirin was made by a company named Bayer, which had invented it just around the turn of the 20th century. It was a German company. Many people in America thought that Bayer had poisoned the aspirin tablets. Bayer actually had to take out advertisements saying that aspirin was made in America by Americans. But this was, again, part of the propaganda and fear campaign that was out there. Many people thought that the Germans had poisoned the water supply, or German spies on U-boats, the submarines, had come ashore and somehow spread these germs around in movie theaters. Of course, it made no sense because the Germans were suffering from it as well, as many people around the world were. But that's the case where misinformation, fear, lies, propaganda, and censorship once again play a role in spreading disease instead of stopping it.
And I think that we can see a connection to what's happening with the coronavirus. You know, there were some at the beginning calling it the Chinese virus because of where it had originated. And then we saw a lot of racism and people blaming Asian people and saying racist things to them. And so I think that fear is something that is a very powerful element of this type of pandemic.
It absolutely is, Jennifer. And that's one of the, I just called you Jennifer and your name is Jessica. Jessica, one of the things I think it's important to learn and keep repeating and hammering here is how important sound information, scientific information based on facts and evidence is when we're talking about the flu and just about anything else we're talking about in terms of history. So that's a real underlying truth that we have to keep returning to. Get your information from reliable sources. Stay away from rumor. Stay away from typical stereotyping. Yes, we have seen terrible things happening to Asian people in the United States because of this idea that this was something that came from China. This is part of the fear that often goes into any crisis situation. I should also add that in World War I, in addition to the flu and Bayer aspirin, people were really afraid of Germans. Many people stopped listening to German music. They wouldn't play Bach or Beethoven on the radios. They renamed Frankfurters, which came from the city of Frankfurt. They were called Liberty Dogs. So that kind of fear and paranoia is always a part of the background of what happens in society when you have bad information compiled with rumor and propaganda.
Absolutely. So let's take a look at those primary sources again to round this out. So on the left, you see is the Philadelphia Parade. And there is not a whole lot of social distancing going on in this image. Look at how those people are crammed in there on the side of the road. And just think about how the influenza is just passing from person to person in this situation. And you know, the reason that this was done is to raise money for the war and to keep up morale, but the effects were devastating. So have your students think about the responses of Philadelphia and St. Louis and maybe talk about comparisons to different cities from today in the coronavirus pandemic. And then on the right is a wonderful image of a postal carrier wearing a gauze mask. And maybe we can talk about essential workers here and think about who were the people that continued to work and continued to be out in communities. What did they do in 1918? What are they doing now in 2020? And since the gauze mask was not incredibly helpful, what can we learn about these essential workers and the response in 1918 that we can apply to 2020? So some great primary sources for you to think about. I'm going to leave you with the bit.ly for the resources and links that Kenneth and I have been sharing. bit.ly/MMore, D deadly. And if you have any questions, please feel free to send them my way at jessica.ellison@mnhs.org. So thank you very much for joining us for episode 3, and we will see you for episode 4.